I don't know if this is new or very old. In some sense, my guess is it's kind of a timeless idea. But since a lot of you are in the senior roles in your organizations, I would like to suggest that one easily neglected aspect of your work is how to help people make sense of things. Who are we? Where are we? But also, what's the context in which we're operating? So one way to say that would be that one aspect of your job is to continually invest in enhancing the intelligence of your enterprise. How people understand the world around them. Now that could be 1.2, could be 1.25, 1.3. Some people would even say it should be 1.7. And you'll see in a minute when I explain a little bit why there's a natural range of uncertainty. But part of the defining feature of the world we live in today is this number. This number refers to how many Earths we presently use. If you look at the total footprint of human activity on the planet, we are way past the one. Probably, I'd say, a kind of consensual perspective of environmental scientists, probably in the latter part of the last century, we passed the one point. Now, this is an inherently ambiguous idea that doesn't make it unimportant. You want to be a good designer in this world today, you obviously have to embrace ambiguity. Well, of course, everything in life is at some level ambiguous, so you pick a few that are particularly important. And I would say there's probably none that are more important than this one. If China were to rise to the level of material affluence and waste of the West, this number would be 2. We would need 2 Earths. If India does likewise, it'll be 3. I would say that's a defining feature of our reality today. Because it means what it means to each person, each organization, each society that takes the time to try to make sense of it. Needless to say, we don't have 2 Earths, we don't have 3, we don't even have 1.5. So we're way past already the point at which human beings could think in any logical, rational basis that we can just keep going the way we're going and everything will be fine. But I would say that just as long as we accept that it's an inherently uncertain notion, every species operating in every biological context or niche operates in the context of something that biologists have called for years a carrying capacity. You know, how many of whatever species can be supported in this biological setting or this geographical setting? Food supply, ability to process wastes, etc. Very basic stuff. Second number. This one's a lot less ambiguous in concept. The idea of a carrying capacity of any species is always a conceptual idea. No one differs with the basic principle behind it. There's always an optimum size of the physical footprint of any species, but what that is and how you calculate it is inherently a very complex scientific question. This one's actually much less complicated. That's the number of people in the world who will not have access to clean drinking water by 2020. Today, it's already well over 1 billion. General estimates, World Health Organization, about 1 billion, 200 million people in the world do not have reliable access to clean drinking water. Not far off, 2020, standard World Health Organization estimate is this will be 2 billion. This is not a new statement right now, but I think it tells us a lot. Actually, water is the new oil. This third one is the one that probably, at least for me, when I first was exposed to it, was the one that really surprised me. And And I wanted to share it. It's a little bit tough to deal with, at least I think it is. You'll draw your own conclusions. Because to me, it kind of completes the picture in a very interesting way. That number is the number of people in the world who die each year from their own hands, suicides, compared to the total number killed in homicides and wars. Year in and year out, for the last two or three decades, particularly for the last decade, three times as many people in the world have killed themselves than have been killed by another. So I'm just sharing these little bits of data to give us something to reflect on. This is one of the real roles of data. We often miss that. It's to get us to stop and pay attention to some aspect of our reality and ask, what does this mean? So obviously, the first and second ones have to do with, Tim used the term yesterday, our kind of multiple crises, the economic and financial crisis, social crises of different sorts. I think he used health as a crisis, and he said ecological crises. For me, and I want to leave you again to think about this a little bit on your own, this third number, which I don't know about you, but when I first heard it, it was kind of really jaw-dropping. And I've heard it now several times, so I think it's in the ballpark of accurate. It suggests something which to me is very important to consider in concert with, let's just say, the social and ecological crises, which is that deep down we may have a crisis of humanness. I mentioned the Global Sustainable Food Laboratory, this network of now about 70 of the world's largest businesses in the food industry and global NGOs. So in addition to Oxfam, World Wildlife, Nature Conservancy, all the big global NGOs, a lot of local ones, all kind of working together, how do we rethink the global food system? One of the things that emerged very early in that process was a sense that there really are multiple levels. It is a social ecological crisis, but it's also a very personal crisis. It's a real human crisis. We have lived in an age, now the we is a little needs a little definition here. If you're from Europe, the we goes on that age maybe as the last 200, 250 years. An American, last 150 200 years. And New Zealand, probably somewhat similar. In China, it's the last 20 or 30 years. We live in an era. The era is called the Industrial Age. It's not over. It wasn't supplanted by the Information Age. That's complete misunderstanding of what the term means. It's an age where, another way to say it would be, materialism becomes the kind of dominant mindset. Many would argue that the Western Scientific Revolution planted the seeds for this. You can look at this in a lot of different ways, but you all remember, well, probably you have heard a little bit of the famous Cartesian dualism. It was a brilliant kind of political move by Descartes, who wrote a letter to the Pope that said, look it, you guys, the church, you focus on the inner world. Re cogens was the Latin term used in the letter. You focus on the inner world. We, the budding scientific community, of course, they didn't have that term for themselves back then, we're going to focus on the physical, material world. Re extensa was the Latin term. And if you stay out of our turf, we'll stay out of yours. It was brilliant. I mean, Descartes and a lot of other scientists at that time did really not want to experience what had happened to Galileo, who was basically under house arrest for the last 20 years of his life. And so, brilliantly, they told the church, look it, we won't deal with that inner world. That's your world. But then you don't have to worry about the outer world. And eventually that came to be accepted. It became a defining feature of Western culture. In a sense, the seeds of materialism were planted right there. That it really is about what's physical. If you ask most scientists in most fields, not quantum physics, but in most fields today, how do you define reality? It's measurability. Measurability defines reality. We know that as business people because we have this, I think, kind of nutty phrase, but it has some element of validity. If you can't measure it, you can't manage it. Right? You see, that really is a cultural statement. It's a culture above the West that began to operate in this manner, that what is real is what you can touch, you can feel, you can see, you can measure, ultimately. Do you have any idea how to measure spirit? I don't mean it in a religious sense now. I mean it in a business sense. How many of you know the difference between a team that has spirit and a team that doesn't have spirit? Yeah. So does that mean we're all kind of living in a fantasy world? Because we've now just illustrated that we deal across this boundary all the time. Because you can't not deal with it if you're really focused on how human beings work together, how they create together. They're not only their productivity, but their generativity. We know what spirit's like. We know what imagination is like. We know what trust is in any organizational setting. Whether or not we can measure it, sure, we can come up with ways to kind of create surrogate measures, but in some sense, we know it's also not going to ever happen. We're never going to be able to weigh it and give the distance. It's not a physical phenomenon. So, even though we've inherited in Western culture this bias towards materialism, we also don't actually live by it because you can't. So I'm just blabbing a little bit to give you another minute or two to think. I would say those three numbers form a set. They tell us a little bit about where we're at physically, in terms of the total footprint of human activity. They tell us where we're at socially. I don't know about you, but the idea of living in a world with 2 billion people who do not have reliable access to clean drinking water does not make me feel too secure about the future. 4 billion, a little less so. As I said, that's the 2030 prediction. The political, social, human implications of that are pretty unsettling. So we've got the physical world, the social world, and ultimately I'll just call it the human world, the one that integrates across all of these. So here's my question, real simple one. The context isn't simple, but the question's simple. What the heck does this mean to you? What might this mean for your organization? Look, at the dumbest, simplest definition of strategy there is how do we have aims or aspirations that are ultimately in harmony with the world we're living into. That's what defines good strategy. It's an aim, it's an aspiration, it's something that pulls you into the future. Obviously, there's a lot of kind of related ideas about how. I mean, David gave a wonderful example yesterday of this kind of fundamental strategic intent within Google to organize and make accessible and useful the world's information. Now, had somebody had that intent 40 years ago, probably been a lot less impactful than 10 years ago. So just to illustrate, all strategy is always about a set of assumptions about the future. And how do we operate in harmony with the future we're moving into? The biggest trick in strategic thinking is always to strike a balance between projectionism and imagination. Because to some degrees, we think about the future through projecting. It's natural. We internalize trends, we project them. At this point right now, there's quite a few of you in here who are going, geez, he said we were going to start talking a long time ago. He's still going on. How long is he going to keep going? Okay, so that's a projection, right? But particularly in times of fundamental change, it's totally and completely inadequate as a strategic perspective. Now, whether or not you regard the disruptions as coming from technology, or you regard them as coming from the physical, social, and let's just say spiritual worlds we live as human beings, I would like to say that there's one common implication of those three numbers. The future is not going to look a lot like the past. Of that, we can be pretty assured. We are in an epoch. I mean, like this term, I think it's the best one that gets at the edge of this without being overly emotional, of a great disruption. The path of human development over the last couple centuries particularly is simply not going to continue. It can't. It's illogical. We do not have two or three Earths. We have one. Human beings need basic things like water. And probably it's fair to say all of us want to live in a world with other people who, by and large, want to live. Period. So, one common implication of the three simple numbers is future is not going to look a lot like the past. And I just want to just underscore one thing, which is probably pretty obvious. This is not about technology, not directly. There's a lot of technological implications in all of this in terms of both how we got into this situation and what will enable us to move forward. But none of those three numbers are prediction of the cost per processing a byte of information or just how rapidly we'll be able to do this or that. I think we're a little caught up in that right now, but I wanted to start with this because to me I would regard this as quite a bit more fundamental. Technology, when all is said and done, I have lived around it my whole life, is about enabling things. The question is always, what do we want to enable? And to answer that question, we have to think a lot about what's the context in which we live. What's the reality of today and the future? So hopefully, I've given you more than enough now to spark not only your projective intelligence, but your imaginative intelligence. Because, of course, that's rather important for why we're here thinking about design.